Did you hear what just happened? Just minutes ago, seconds ago? It's community. It's people coming together to worship God. That's something that we've been missing throughout this pandemic, and I thank you for taking the time to join us for worship this morning. Our first praise and prayer hymn is, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus.
Are there any announcements that we need to make?
bring to your attention this morning is taken from Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, verse 34. He called the crowd of his disciples and said to them, "If you want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me."
God.
Could you join me for the acronym's modern definition as found printed in your book? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, outside the universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord our God, you are always more ready to bestow your good gifts on us than we are to seek them, and are willing to give more than we desire or deserve. Help us to seek that we may truly find, so that as that we may joyfully receive, so deny that the door of your mercy may be opened to us. Through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. My next hymn is Birdies. Thank you. In our book study, we've been studying the book The Walk by Anne Hamilton. Anne Hamilton reminds his readers that Jesus not only read the scripture, he memorized it, he prayed it, and he lived it. We are blessed to be able to share Holy Scripture with you this morning.
Today's Old Testament reading comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 17, verses 1 through 7 and 15 through 16. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you and will make you exceedingly numerous." Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you." God said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her." Today's gospel lesson comes from the book of Mark, chapter 8, verses 31 through 38. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter stood beside him and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd of his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Say so clearly and with such force that we couldn't deny who the message was from or what we were supposed to do. Hamilton calls such actions by God special revelations. He believes that special revelations are God's direct disclosure of the divine self and the divine will. He says in the video that special revelation from God seldom comes to us as a shout. More often, special revelation is a whisper from God. Abram has a special revelation, just like the one that Noah had 10 generations earlier. The revelation he receives from the Lord is another covenant. Peter will also have a special revelation in Mark's gospel, but it comes in the form of a rebuke from Jesus. In both instances, God is disclosing himself and his will directly to his people. In Genesis 17, verses 1 through 7, we find the third repetition of the special revelation for Abraham. Each time, the Lord promises a covenant with him that requires something from both parties. In the first encounter, Abraham lost his home. In the second, he lost his security. And here in the third, he will lose his name. Now, the Lord's part of the covenant is a promise of descendants and land for Abraham and his descendants. The promises from the Lord and the covenant require some sacrifice on the part of Abraham, of Abram. He's been called to leave the familiar and venture out without a clear direction, only trust. He's called to believe he had a home, a place despite being surrounded by enemies. And now he's called to take on a new identity and to live that identity with the remainder of his life. At his first encounter with God, the text tells us that Abram was 75 years old. And in today's text, he's now 99 years old. And still, there is no son. No Isaac. There is no multitude as numerous as the stars in the heavens or the sand in the desert. Yet God comes and asks for an investment. God asks for a sacrifice as a sign that Abram is still on board, 24 years into the covenant. Is he still on board? Oh, for sure, he's had his moments when he wasn't so sure, when he felt the need to save himself, because God seems so far away. You can't blame him, really. He's getting on in years. He and Sarah are seeing a gerontologist rather than a pediatrician. It's a long time to hold on to hope. A long time to see a future that was so far from reality, the reality in which they were living. It's almost like that. This time, the Lord seals the covenant with Abraham by changing his name. Abram means father is exalted. Abraham is a linguistic variant of Abram with the same meaning. But the text presents the new name, Abraham, to mean father of a multitude. A new name signifies a new phase in the life of its bearer. And in verses 15 and 16, there is another special revelation to include Sarah, in the covenant. Like Abraham, she's given a new name, Sarah, making the covenant relationship a family affair. Sarah's new name is a blessing rather than a covenant obligation. The covenant promises of abundant biological offspring is extended to the elderly woman whose womb has been closed before this special revelation. But there are other conditions in the covenant. Abraham is to walk before God, and he blames. Blames. What does that include? This is only the second time in the Old Testament in which the word blameless will appear. The first time was when Noah was introduced. So blameless means, then, good enough to save humanity. No pressure there. Genesis 6:9 says Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. Noah walked with God. Being blameless and walking are tied together. Our covenant maker God is saying to Abraham, keep moving forward. Keep moving forward with me. Don't give up on the promise. Even as the years pass and the body ages, keep walking with me. Walking before me. Now there was a shift between the covenants with Noah and Abraham. Noah walked with God, and Abraham is told to walk before God. Before might mean on display. It might mean to represent. For Abraham, before means that he and Sarah had to walk without all the answers for the rest of their life of faith. They had to walk before God even before they were given specific directions. They had to decide for themselves how to follow this new path of faith. To be sure, they got it wrong sometimes. They made decisions that got themselves into trouble, and they put each other and loved ones at risk. Abraham and Sarah messed up, I'm sure. But none of that precluded them from continuing to walk before God. Sometimes, they had to back down, pick themselves up and go a different direction. Sometimes they hurt those around them by making the wrong choices. But they kept on walking, kept seeking, kept asking for God's guidance. And when it came, they changed direction. They changed their identities. Well, God changed their identities. He was Abram, exalted father, but he became Abraham, father of many. And Sarai became Sarah, making this new covenant a family affair. The exalted one has to be God. And what is needed from Abraham and Sarah was a sense that there were others who would follow their example. Yes, there was the literal interpretation of the new names. A nation of people would come, but slowly. And there was a spiritual interpretation. Abraham and Sarah's faithfulness partnered together to spawn a multitude of children. We who come after seek to walk before God with as much faith as they do. Changing identities is what Jesus is doing in Mark chapter 8, verses 31 through 38. He starts with a statement of his immediate future of persecution and suffering. This is his disclosure of self as Messiah, and he will endure through persecution. But Peter objects strongly to Jesus' He understood that Jesus was the Messiah, because earlier in the gospel, when Jesus asked the disciples, "Who do you say I am?" Peter replies, "You are the Messiah." That's Mark chapter 8, verse 29. What Peter doesn't understand is how the Messiah's entrance into the world should turn out. By his statement, it's obvious he felt his opinion was superior to that of Jesus. Oops. Peter is only demonstrating his immense arrogance. Jesus' sharp rebuke of Peter in verses 30 and 32 identifies Peter with Satan, the very same Satan that tempted Jesus in the desert, back in Mark chapter 1, verse 13. The level of rebuke indicates that Peter's negative interpretations of Jesus' disclosure are in fact wrong. After rebuking Peter, Jesus calls the crowds together with the disciples to teach them about what following the suffering Messiah really means. This is where the identity change begins to take place. Jesus is asking his followers to walk with him to the cross. The cross, that very horrific instrument used by the Romans and other authorities for executions, is what awaits Jesus and is the probable end for all who might follow him. Those who are willing to follow Jesus on this path of service and sacrifice will be identified with him by that very sign on the cross. That is a sign that they are a new people and followers of a new Jesus. It will be the very cross that Jesus first himself will bear, and then his followers will have to bear after him. Jesus says, if anyone will become my followers, they let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. He knows the path will be difficult and that there will be times when they'll feel alone and frightened. But if they walk and live their new identity of this cross, they don't have anything to be ashamed of. Jesus knows that following him will be a challenge. And like Abraham and Sarah, Peter and the disciples and other followers, Jesus will be there through all the fits and starts and doubts and repentance. These are conditions that are part of the life of the new people identified as followers of Jesus. As we continue our Lenten journey this week, remember, we're following a servant king who had to suffer and went before him, before us. Take up your cross and follow Jesus confidently that he is with us throughout our Lenten journey, even to the very end. Amen. Would you join me in that attitude of prayer? Creator God, though people may turn their backs on us, you do not hide your face from us. Though others may try to take away our hope, you assure us that future is waiting for us. You speak your name and scribble Creator, and it is enough. When we try to dictate our fears to you, you invite us to follow you into self-denial and service. As we struggle to shape our lifestyle to yours, you carry us with you wherever you go. You speak your good news, teacher of open hearts, and it is enough. Though we have done nothing to earn them, you pour out the gifts of grace and mercy upon us. When we stumble over our lack of trust, you set us back on our feet to follow you into the kingdom. You speak your peace, breath of holiness, and it is enough. Dear Lord, be with those that we have included in our prayer list this morning. Guide and comfort them for whatever the circumstances they are facing. Encourage and strengthen us as your disciples as we try to show them and all the world of your love. Please join me in a few moments of silent prayer. God and community, holy and one, it is enough that you hear us, even as we pray as your Son comes. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God has blessed us this week, as I'm sure he's blessed you. When we come to that time in our service when we can share those blessings with the rest of the faith community. If you haven't had an opportunity to put your envelope in the basket at the back, please raise your hand and Chris will stop and see you on your way forward.
Thank you.
to hear Christ claiming you as his own. We go in the mercy of Christ. Go forth to follow where the Spirit sends you. We go in the power.